Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. My name is Ibrahim Muthanna. I am 6th stage medical student at Al Mustansiriya University College of Medicine. Today, me and my colleague Ghufran Saad Ahmed, we will present parathyroid gland supervised by Dr. Mustafa Osama. We will start our lecture by talking about the anatomy of the parathyroid glands. The parathyroid glands, of which there are four, developed from the third and fourth pharyngeal pouch between the 5th and 12th week of gestation. They are typically described as Portland brick, as being yellow brown in color and weigh approximately 30 milligram, and approximately 13% of population have abnormal parathyroid tissue, with 5% having a true supranumerary gland. The blood supply of the both superior and inferior parathyroid gland arises from a branch from inferior thyroidal artery. The inferior parathyroid glands and the thymus arise from the third pharyngeal pouch. As a result of the longer normal embryological descent, there is a correspondingly more variation in their anatomical position. While the superior parathyroid glands arise from the dorsal portion of the fourth pharyngeal pouch. As we mentioned previously, there is a variation in the site and location of the parathyroid glands. In more than 50% of cases, the inferior parathyroid gland are located in the inferior pole of the thyroid gland on the anterior, lateral, or posterior surface, while in more than 80% of patients, the superior parathyroid glands are located at the posterior aspect of the thyroid lobe, in area 2 cm in diameter, centered 1 cm around the junction of the inferior thyroid artery and the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Now, regarding the function of the parathyroid gland, the main action of it is to release the parathyroid hormone, which also known as parathormone, which released to maintain the level of calcium within the serum. So if we have a low level of plasma calcium concentration, the parathyroid gland will release the parathyroid hormone, which increase calcium level mobilized from the bone, and also increase renal tubular absorption of the calcium, and also lead to activation of the vitamin D, which increase the calcium absorption in the intestine. In all these manners, it will lead to an increase of the plasma calcium concentration. Now we will have a case presentation. A 44-year-old lady, not known to have any chronic illness, before presented with a history of bone pain in the hip joint of unknown duration. She sought a medical advice and managed conservatively with bed rest, and now returned to her physician again after 3 months with unresolved symptoms, where he requested for a set of blood investigation that showed a high serum calcium level. What could be the differential diagnosis for the elevated serum calcium, and what is the diagnosis for our case? As we can see here, the causes of hypercalcemia is either related to the endocrine with primary hyperparathyroidism or thyrotoxicosis or pheochromocytoma, or related to the renal in the form of secondary or tertiary hyperparathyroidism or malignant disease. Also, there are nutritional causes, granulomatous. But we mentioned in our case that all that she complained is hip joint pain. All the investigations were normal. No other complaint, no chronic illness or medical disease, so the most likely diagnosis is primary hyperparathyroidism. Now, primary hyperparathyroidism. The early descriptions of patients with primary hyperparathyroidism were dominated by those with osteitis fibrosa cystica, which is a brown tumors of long bones and associated with the subperiosteal bone reabsorption. Distal tapering of the clavicles and the classical salt and pepper erosion of the skull were typical findings. Over 80% of patients had unassociated with renal stone, significant neuromuscular dysfunction, and muscle weakness. And these will form the traditional mnemonic that patients with primary hyperparathyroidism presented with: bones, stones, abdominal groans, and psychiatric overtones. The majority of patients are now identified incidentally on routine biochemical investigations, and they are asymptomatic. Over 40% of patients will have hypercalciuria, and increasingly postmenopausal women present with significant osteopenia or osteoporosis in the distal one-third of the radius, with a minimal reduction in the lumbar spine, which promote further investigations. The distribution arises as the parathyroid hormone appears to be catabolic at the cortical sites, like distal one-third of the radius, and anabolic at cancellous sites, like lumbar spine. Common epidemiologically linked disorders such as hypertension and peptic ulcer disease are often encountered, and the clinical examination is usually normal. Brand keratopathy, which is pathognomonic of the disease and due to the deposition of the calcium phosphate crystals in the cornea, which is now rarely to be identified, as we can see here in the picture. The underlying etiology of primary hyperparathyroid is usually a solitary parathyroid adenoma. However, in a small number of patients, 2-4%, there are double adenomas. It may occur in a sporadic fashion, or it can be a familial, like MEN type 1 or type 2A, or hyperparathyroidism jaw tumor syndrome. The only known risk factor for development of primary hyperparathyroidism is a history of prior NEX irradiation. Diagnosis. The diagnosis mainly is biochemical. Only when the disease has been confirmed biochemically, the localization study can be undertaken. Positive imaging does not confirm the diagnosis, and negative findings cannot rule it out. Primary hyperparathyroidism is defined as unelevated total, or more specifically ionized calcium, in the presence of inappropriately elevated or unsuppressed parathyroid hormone. It is associated with a low serum phosphate in the setting of normal creatinine and vitamin D levels. A 24-hour urinary excretion of calcium may be normal or elevated. It is important to perform a 24-hour urinary collection to rule out the presence of a rare familial hypocalciuric hypercalcemia. Alkaline phosphatase may be elevated in patients in whom there is a concomitant bone disease. Now we'll start talking about the imaging techniques for parathyroid gland, starting with nuclear medicine-based study, system EB scanning. It's now regarded as the most accurate and reliable method for imaging the parathyroid gland. It is safe, reproducible, and while it has sensitivity and specificity similar to that of ultrasound, it may image glands in ectopic positions better. The sensitivity and specificity of system EB, regardless of the protocol, are 79% and 90% respectively. False positives are rare but may arise from some solid thyroid nodules, such as Hartle cell nodule, that are associated with high oxophilic content. As we can see here in the image, the system EB scanning showing a right inferior parathyroid gland adenoma. For ultrasonography, it is non-invasive, inexpensive method of imaging the parathyroid glands. Parathyroid adenoma are typically oval, elongated, bi or multi-lobed hypoechoic structures. Rarely, adenoma may be a cystic or heterogeneous in nature. The specificity and sensitivity for ultrasonography is almost similar to that of system EB. But the limitation is that ultrasonography is operator, lesion, size, and location dependent. Critically, ultrasound may miss adenoma located in the retroesophageal, retrosternal, or retrotracheal area. And over here we can see the image showing an hypoechoic mass within the parathyroid gland, which is a parathyroid adenoma. Regarding the 4D CT, multiphase CT imaging has become widely utilized to localize disease. It gives both anatomical and functional information about the parathyroid glands. Using pre-contrast, post-contrast, and delayed images, it demonstrates not only detailed anatomical localization, but combined with a rapid uptake and washout, allow hyperfunctioning glands to be differentiated from lymph node. The potential disadvantage of 4D CT is of having higher radiation. Now for the invasive imaging technique, we have a parathyroid angiography and venous sampling for parathyroid hormone. Parathyroid angiography and venous sampling for parathyroid hormone is reserved only for reoperative cases and is now rarely required due to the improvement in the non-invasive imaging modalities. It involves examination of both thyrocervical trunk, both internal mammary arteries and carotids, with occasional selective superior thyroid artery catheterization. Vascular parathyroid adenoma appears as a persistent oval or round stain on angiography. Serious complications such as contrast-induced renal failure, embolization, and neurological damage have limited its utility. Regarding the management of primary hyperparathyroidism, the mainstay of treatment For primary hyperparathyroidism is surgery, addressing the underlying etiology and allowing not only resolution of biochemical abnormalities but also sustained improvement in end organ damage. All symptomatic patients should be offered surgery. And for asymptomatic patient, an expert panel recently published recommendation on which asymptomatic patient should be considered for surgical intervention. These include the measurement of serum calcium level and bone marrow density by DEXA scan, and also renal function test and the age of the patient, as we can see over here in this table. When criteria have been met and where a single adenoma has been confidently identified by a radiological mean, a minimally invasive parathyroidectomy may be offered. Conversely, where there is a discoordinate imaging or when imaging fails to identify any parathyroid abnormalities, then a bilateral neck exploration and 3.5 gland parathyroidectomy or a 4 gland parathyroidectomy with autotransplantation should be performed. While the consent for parathyroidectomy must include the following: the possibilities of recurrent laryngeal nerve damage, which is less than 1%, the permanent hypoparathyroidism, which requiring calcium and vitamin D supplementation, with a risk of 0.5%, and a persistent or recurrent hyperparathyroidism, which counts for 5%. Persistent disease can be defined as elevated serum calcium within 6 weeks after surgical intervention, and recurrent disease is defined as an increase in calcium level after 6 months but with an intervening period of normal calcemia. For minimally invasive approach are based mainly on the principle that over 80% of individuals with primary hyperparathyroidism have a single adenoma. It commonly refers to the removal of a localized abnormal parathyroid gland through an incision less than 3 cm in length. The term encompasses open approach, central and lateral incision, video-assisted and radio-guided parathyroidectomies. A number of randomized studies have shown that a focused approach has similar cure rates to the cervical exploration, but with reduced rate of post-operative hypocalcemia, shorter operating time, and potentially less pain and better cosmetics. Regarding bilateral neck exploration, a traditional cervical neck exploration is required where imaging is negative or in men type 1 or type 2A or in lithium-induced primary hyperparathyroidism. A transverse collar, also known as Kocher incision, is made and the subplatysmal plane developed. The deep cervical fascia is divided between the strap muscles and these are retracted. The thyroid lobes are mobilized and the middle thyroid vein may be divided when present. Identification of the recurrent laryngeal nerve and the middle thyroid artery allows a starting point for a systemic exploration. All four glands are identified. 3.5 glands are resected with a half of vascularized parathyroid left in situ. Alternatively, all four glands can be resected and a forearm autotransplantation can be created. Small pieces of parathyroid are sutured into a pocket created in the brachioradialis muscle. Permanent hypoparathyroidism represents one of the most serious complications of parathyroidectomy. It's defined as continuing need of calcium and or vitamin D replacement at 1 year post-op. It represents a rare complication if it occurs with primary hyperparathyroidism only 0.5%, while in secondary hyperparathyroidism it can range from 4 to 12%. Symptoms and signs relate to serum calcium level. Symptoms include mild circumoral or digital numbness and paresthesia, carpopedal or laryngeal spasm and cardiac arrhythmia. Chauvistic and Trousseau sign may be elected. Chauvistic sign is referred to the contraction of the ipsilateral facial muscle on percussion of the facial nerve below the zygoma, while Trousseau sign refer to the development of carpopedal spasm secondary to occlusion of the arm, usually occur with a blood pressure cuff. The biochemical investigation include total ionized calcium level as well as serum magnesium level. An ECG may be demonstrated a prolonged QT interval or QRS changes. Mild hypocalcemia can be treated with oral calcium and vitamin D supplementation, while acute symptomatic hypocalcemia is an emergency and should be corrected with intravenous as well as oral calcium and vitamin D replacement. Traditionally, 10 ml of 10% calcium gluconate is administered slowly IV. Supplemental magnesium may be also required due to the synergistic action of transporter for calcium and magnesium. Now we're going to talk about the medical management of primary hyperparathyroidism. The medical management is warranted in patients who are deemed unfit or who have contraindication to the surgical intervention, and also in patients with the failed surgical intervention or in a long-term management of parathyroid carcinoma. The aims are to prevent skeletal complication, which include improving bone mineral density and reduced fracture risk, and to stabilize biochemical parameters. One of the medical management include bisphosphonate, which is a pyrophosphate analog that are concerned in area of high bone turnover. They inhibit osteoclast activity and apoptosis, thereby it's increased bone mineralization and reducing bone turnover. Also, for medical management, we have hormone replacement therapy, which has shown to improve bone mineral density and reduce the associated fracture risk in postmenopausal women by reducing bone turnover. Two non-randomized controlled trials have shown that they have similar effect to the surgery for primary hyperparathyroidism at 4 years, with improvement in bone mineral density but without any improvement in the underlying serum biochemistry. Also, we have calcium mimetics. The extracellular calcium sensitizing receptor on the parathyroid cell surface negatively regulate secretion of parathyroid hormone. Activation of the receptor decreases the secretion of parathyroid hormone, thereby decreasing the bone turnover. The use of calcium mimetics has gained a widespread acceptable in secondary hyperparathyroidism, but primary hyperparathyroidism, it's largely limited to the patient who are unfit for surgery. Now we're going to talk about familial causes of primary hyperparathyroidism. These include first, familial isolated hyperparathyroidism. Isolated familial hyperparathyroidism occur when patients have a primary hyperparathyroidism without any other associated endocrinopathies. The syndrome has been linked to known mutation in the MEN type 1 gene and also the HRPT2 gene. Hyperparathyroidism should be treated with a formal bilateral neck exploration and management as per patient with multiple endocrine neoplasia. So also we have multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1 associated hyperparathyroidism. MEN type 1 is a rare autosomal dominant syndrome consisting of a tumor of the parathyroid, endocrine pancreas and duodenum, and the pituitary, which also known as the 3Ps. Patients typically present with young onset, 20 to 30 years old of age, of symptomatic hyperparathyroidism, and over 95% of patients will have a primary hyperparathyroidism before the age of 40 years. It is associated with the presence of multi-gland parathyroid disease and as such has mandated a bilateral cervical exploration with at least subtotal parathyroidectomy and cervical thymectomy. Recurrent disease remain high in this group of patients. It's up to 62%. And also we have multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2A associated hyperparathyroidism. It consists of medullary thyroid carcinoma, unilateral or bilateral pheochromocytoma, and primary hyperparathyroidism. Primary hyperparathyroidism occurs in approximately 20% of patients. The majority of patients will be asymptomatic with a mild elevation in calcium and asymmetry in large parathyroid glands. It is extremely important that the presence of a pheochromocytoma is included prior to surgical intervention. Surgery is usually performed for medullary thyroid carcinoma, with the parathyroid enlargement often being a coincidental intraoperative finding. In this setting, with extensive surgery for medullary thyroid carcinoma, the primary aim of treatment is to avoid hypoparathyroidism. And also we have parathyroid-jaw-tumor syndrome. It's a rare cause of primary hyperparathyroidism. It arises due to inactivating mutation in the HRP2T2 gene on chromosome number 1, which encoding the parafibromin. It classically presents with early onset of primary hyperparathyroidism. The mean age is 32, the etiology of which can be either a single or multiple disease of the gland, but it is predominantly cystic in nature. It presents with severe hypercalcemia and is associated with an increased risk of underlying parathyroid carcinoma. Approximately 40% of patients will have the pathognomonic ossifying jaw fibroma of the maxilla or the mandible. Surgical intervention involve removal of all enlarged parathyroid glands. Finally, we have familial hypocalciuric hypercalcemia. It's not a surgical disease, and therefore preoperative diagnosis is imperative for the surgeon. It arises as a result of heterogeneous mutation in the calcium receptor gene on chromosome number 3. Patients with this condition have a normal or slightly elevated parathyroid hormone and increase in serum magnesium level and hypocalciuria. A low urinary calcium creatinine clearance ratio is used to discriminate between this condition and mild primary hyperparathyroidism. Patients rarely require intervention, and surgical intervention is not indicated.